So here I'm presenting the work that I've done together with Dr. Chiara Bonacchi at University of Stirling, and Chiara is actually here as well in the audience. I'll be discussing how to handle the social media data in digital heritage research. And in particular, in the first part of the presentation, I focus on the data extraction methods, the data management and archiving. While in the second part, I present a case study which will show how we used some of the text analysis techniques to interpret our data. So our work on social media was done as part of the large interdisciplinary project Ancient Identities in Modern Britain. And it was an AHRC-funded project done jointly between the University of Stirling and Darnley University. And the aim of the project was to explore the diversity of heritages created from Iron Age, Roman, and early medieval past by stakeholders across Britain. And we wanted to explore both heritages that are created offline and those that were created online. And our colleagues in Darnley focused a lot on the offline ethnography. Well, we wanted to develop the online methods to explore these heritages online. And to do that, we also aimed to develop a mixed methodology that would incorporate both qualitative methods and analysis and data intensive methods that were necessary to deal with the quantities of data that we obtained. So, in our data set, we've noticed a lot of properties that are usually attributed to the so-called big data. And this included not only the large volume, but in particular the high velocity of the data. So the fact that it was not only being created, but also deleted in real time. And the fact that the data had a very diverse structure. And these properties forced us to adjust our workflows and adjust our methodology. But not only this, but also it made us think a little bit differently about our data. To illustrate this, there are two possible ways to collect data from social media. One of them is to collect them as they appear on the internet. So the data streaming approach, and the problem with this approach is that it's a little bit limiting in that it doesn't give you access to historic data, only the ones that are appearing at the time. In that, the part of data that you get may not always be the most appropriate for the research questions that you want to ask. For example, if right now I wanted to collect the data that would let me look into the how the past was used or leveraged during the general elections in the UK, I wouldn't be able to obtain this data with this approach right now because the elections were last year. So I wouldn't get any relevant information. And the other thing is that it requires appropriate infrastructure that allows you to collect the data continuously, so you need a constant connection to the internet. So the other approach is to collect all the data that is present in a given moment on a social media platform at once, at the moment. This works very well if you want to extract a relatively small amount of data. But as soon as you try to extract a lot of pages, for example, from Facebook or a lot of tweets from Twitter, your data collection process starts stretching from one day to many days or weeks or even months. And as a result, during this time, the data that you are collecting is in constant state of change. So if you are two people extracting exactly the same data set with the same method at the same time, could end up with completely different data sets in the end because the order in which they were extracting specific parts of the data set was different. The fact that our data had high velocity, that it was in the constantly changing, meant that the data set that we got in the end could not be exhaustive in scope, because we weren't able to get all the possible data that was ever available on the social media platform, but we weren't even able to get the data that was available on the social media platform at the time of the data collection, only some parts of it. And it was very difficult to define what part it actually was. Another issue that resulted from the high velocity of the data was the fact that in our workflows, the error handling mechanism became crucial, because we started encountering all kinds of errors that didn't appear on the input of small data sets. And they could result, for example, from the connection timeout, that happened very often, but also from the rate limits if we're collecting data from the social media APIs, and also from the fact that when the data disappeared before we started collecting them, the algorithm wasn't able to find it, so it also resulted in errors. So another issue that we encountered during the data collection is the fact that we had to use the search engines of social media platforms that were not very clever in understanding what we actually wanted, because they don't distinguish between different meanings of the words. So as an example, Roman can refer to the Roman period, but it can also refer to the name or to the Roman Catholic Church. And there are a few ways to deal with it. There are some automated ways to disambiguate the meanings of different words, but they are not always available specifically for the words that you need at the moment. So there's also a possibility to verify them manually if the amount of data is limited. But this is not always possible, because these methods may not be available. So the way to deal with it is to use search phrases and terms that have only one meaning, or for example, to use more specific search phrases, such as instead of using the word Roman, use the phrase Roman Empire, or ancient Rome instead of just Rome. Or we can focus only on specific Facebook pages, for example, or Twitter accounts, in which we know that when these words are used, they will be used in the context that we're interested in. The problem is that if we use any of the last three approaches, we are actually limiting what kind of data we can get from social media, and therefore we're also limiting the kind of research questions that we can ask of it. So the last issue to do with data collection is that there are two ways to access the data that's present on social media platforms. And one of them is to go through the API, which is the ways that most social media platforms provide that allows you to access only a very specific data, part of data that you're interested in, such as, for example, if you just want the text of the messages, it lets you go just for the text. And as such, it's very efficient, because you don't need to extract the whole page, so it's much faster than the other approach. And it's also easier to work with, it's much easier to debug. What's more, the interface is available in multiple languages. And therefore, it's available to people with different levels of technical expertise. Those researchers who are comfortable with only one programming language can also use these methods much easier. The problem is that the API access is controlled by social media platforms, and as such, the kind of data that you can extract can change over time, and the access to the API can just be blocked at one point. And this is, of course, a problem that happens in the middle of your data collection process. But it also has a consequence for reproducibility, because when that happens, the workflow you develop, even if you publish your code and try to make it open and accessible, after a short period of time, you know, you're going to be working. And that actually happened to some of our codes, because I think in May this year, Facebook restricted the access to the API, So all of the code that was published is no longer working. And the alternative to it is to use the wave scraping approach, which is more difficult and slightly less comfortable, because it requires the familiarity not only with one programming language, but it specifically requires the knowledge of HTML structure and HTML selectors. It's more difficult to debug because HTML structure is more variable and the data collection process is slower. But the advantage of that is that it's a more universal approach. So if you use this approach, it allows you to access a wider range of online resources, not just the social media platforms that have API access. And everything that can be viewed in the browser, in principle, can be at any point extracted with this approach. So there's less a possibility that social media platforms will block this access. Of course, the way the websites are structured can also be changed, but it's less likely to change over a longer period of time, because blocking the API access is very easy for social media platforms. And changing the HTML structure will result in the changes of the social media platform interface. Will be complicated because they will need to ensure that it's still working properly. So it's much more likely that it will be announced in advance, that you will be able to prepare for it, and that the changes won't be that radical. So the high variability of the data structures that we encountered also forces us to adjust our data management strategy. And because our data was very often very hierarchical, like for example Facebook, where you have public Facebook pages and then under them you have posts, under posts there are comments, under comments there are replies. And then within all these levels, the data is also structured in a very variable way, so some of the fields in the data contain just text, but some of them may contain lists or arrays, and this doesn't fit very well in the traditional relational databases. So we used a non-just relational Mongo database to facilitate this. On the basis of that, we developed the whole data management infrastructure, which contains two databases, to one of which we are constantly streaming the data that was produced in real time. And then it was processed and put into the static database. And in the static database, we also extracted some of the data, some of the historic data, in one go. All of these data were then further processed, clean, and what's important, anonymized for the ethical reasons. The last issue of the data management is archiving on social media data, which is a very problematic issue to which at this point there isn't an easy solution. And there are two main reasons for that. One of them is that the data that's there were not meant for archiving in the first place. And on one hand, we don't know, it's not clear how we would be able to get the permissions of content creators and whether it would be ethical to archive it without their explicit permission. The other issue is that some of the social media platforms' owners actually don't allow you to republish their data. So some people try to work around it. There is a database of tweets in the Harvard database, for example, which doesn't actually store Twitter data, it just stores Twitter IDs, and there is a program that allows you to retrieve the tweets that contain these IDs. The problem is that, as I said, it doesn't actually store the data. So if it's deleted from the social media platforms, you are no longer able to access them. The other issue is the problem with choosing what to actually archive. There's the case of the US Congress Library, which decided to collect all of the tweets for a couple of years, not for research purposes, but just for the documentation purposes. But the problem is that this year they decided that they're going to stop doing that and be more selective simply because they didn't have infrastructure for it. So currently we are thinking about putting our data with archaeological data service and selecting those that we use for specific research and that are related to the published research papers. So at the end, I'm going to present a small case study which will show how we use the trauma methods of text analysis. In this study, we wanted to look into how the objects, places, people, and practices from the past were used in the discussions about Brexit. And to that, we extracted all the public Facebook pages from Brexit and their contents. And within this big data set, we found a smaller data set that contained period-specific keywords that's related to the past. And to analyze it, we developed an approach that mixed qualitative and quantitative methods and was based on the interethnography. So some of the methods we used included topic modeling. And we used the topic modeling to get an idea of all the issues that were discussed in relation to Brexit in general, not just in relation to the small data set with keywords. And we found that there was quite a diversity of issues discussed, ranging from economy, migration, the possible consequences of Brexit, and so on. And then we compared it to the actual to the topics discussed within this small data set, in which that the past was actually used, and we found that there is a lot of difference, that there is only a very small subset of issues that appears in the smaller data set, and that's mostly to do with migration. And then we focused on the smaller data set. We also used some very simple quantitative methods to see what of the keywords that we used for search were appearing the most, and we use terms associations to see what other terms are associated with them. And we found some interesting patterns that then guided our qualitative analysis, and Chiara looked into the specific text of Facebook messages in more details, and she identified that three myths appear in these messages quite a lot. The myth of origin, which focuses on, which has two variations. So one of them is the pro-remain one, the other one is pro-leave one, the myth of resistance and the myth of collapse. And they were used both by pro-leave and pro-remain sides. They were generally constructed around the oppositions of, for example, civilization and barbarism. And to conclude, because of the big data nature of our data set, we found that it requires appropriate infrastructure in order to handle, but it also presents a challenge for research reproducibility. And it has at least some logical consequences because in some ways it guided our research questions and it also, when we analyzed the social media data, we saw that in order to fully understand it, it requires both the use of data-intensive quantitative methods, but at the core of it is the qualitative approach and the internet ethnography. Thank you very much.